You're listening to Antidote to Deception Internet Radio Program, a program designed to present the truth as it is in Jesus, and to present Jesus as the antidote to deception. Please join us now for the next half hour as we explore the biblical truth as it is in Jesus. Hello and welcome to the Antidote to Deception Internet Radio Program for Wednesday, April 8, 2015. This week we're looking at A Date with Destiny, preparing for the judgment. Today's topic is entitled Minding the Minutes. Before we get into our message, however, I would just like to first of all take the time to remind you that you can visit us on our website at theantidotetodeception.com. You can like us on Facebook at facebook.com/thewordmaster. Presents. Also, follow us on Twitter at WordmasterBlog and subscribe to our videos on YouTube at TheWordmasterBlog. If you ever want to get in contact with us, just leave us an email at TheWordMasterPresents@gmail.com. Now, for our scripture for the week, Revelation chapter 20, verse 11 and 12. Revelation 20, 11 and 12. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life, and the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works. We'll begin our day's presentation after these items of selected music.
Take myself and I will be wondered how to come to you. I did not dare believe it true that you regard the orphaned ones, beloved daughters, worthy sons. The broken and the barren too, I heard could find some rest in what kind of love in injury's place would leave in his stead the stain of grace? So I come in sorrow, I come in shame, I come to the cross with my pain. Just as I am
welcome to the Antidote to Deception Internet Radio Program. On Tuesday's presentation, we began our series for the week, A Date with Destiny, looking at the thought of remember now you're created in the days of your youth. Today, we will be looking at Mindful of the Minutes, showing us the importance of redeeming the time. Before we begin our study, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you so much for your loving kindness and your tender mercies towards us. Thank you, dear God, for watching over us, dear Lord. Thank you for being with us. And now, unseen guest in our study. Look over our shoulders, dear God, as we look at the scriptures, as we meditate upon these words, as we consider what we are to do in these times, as we prepare for our date with destiny. We do pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, one thing that we did say yesterday was that destiny always has a way of meeting her appointments. And today, we will continue that thought. Again, our key scripture takes us to Romans chapter 13, 11 through 14. Romans chapter 13, verses 11 through 14. Our time, and there, and that knowing the time, that now is high time to wake our sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. We are redeeming the time because of days are evil. Ephesians 5 and verse 16. Notice in Romans chapter 13 and 11, in just that one introductory verse alone, it speaks so many times of time. We know the time. It's time to awake our salvation nearer. The most important thing to note is that we are told we know the time. We are mindful of the minutes of probationary time left to us. And why? Beautiful thought. We can see the signs again, signs of the time. We know just because we are students of the Word, we are students of prophecy, that what the Bible predicted to happen is happening, has happened. We know that all that needs to happen is a very few final events in our world's history. That's why we need to be mindful of the time. You know, one thing I'm keenly aware of as I begin dialoguing with you today is that if you run out of sugar, you can go to the store and buy more sugar. If your dress or your shoes or any other item wears out, runs out, damaged, lost, stolen, you can go out and buy more. There's not anywhere you can go to buy back time. And so, friends, it is very important that we understand these principles as we continue. Once time has passed, once time has been spent, it can never be returned. Spend the time wisely. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. The night is far spent, as we just said. History, the Bible, told us that the many prophecies that were told that would happen prior to our time is happening. And all that we're doing now is watching for the final end time events. But dear friends, let us remember that we're being mindful of the minutes because we have a date with destiny. We will either be in front of or behind the white throne in the time of judgment. On Thursday's program, we'll explore this thought more as we come to our conclusion. Verse 12 also tells us, let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. So there is a putting off and a putting on as we mind the minutes. Because we know what is at stake, because we are keenly aware of what we are to be doing at this time, the Bible tells us, let us do it. Verse 13, let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envying. So important, my friends. Notice that it doesn't say in murdering and stealing, in adultery, etc. But it literally tells us, let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in foolishness, not in squandering the time doing idle things. And notice it even tells us chambering is sleeping, physically. You don't sleep away the time. And just, again, idleness, not in strife and envy, and speaking to us, beloved. Letter to the Romans, speaking to God's people. We don't have time to be at each other's throats. We don't have time to be idle. We don't have time to just be taking these days for granted. Once time has been spent, it can never be brought back. Remember that. Verse 14 tells us, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. And that's the takeaway, beloved, that as we see the end approaching, as we see murders and all types of vices and evilness just taking a hold of the planet, engulfing it in darkness, dear friends, we must be enclosed in the armor of light, dear friends, putting on the Lord Jesus Christ, the armor of light. So he protects us from being entangled by the lust of the flesh. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Be mindful of the minutes and have him watch with us. Ephesians 5:16 tells us, redeeming the time because the days are evil. As we just said over and over again, and we understand that the word to our minds, redeem, means to buy back. But here it just means that we are thoughtful, that we are aware, that we spend opportune time that we have in doing that which is right, because the days are evil. And what days are eviler than the days in which we've come? You could be standing in a movie theater line, and because the person behind you doesn't like the way that you're singing that tune, pulls out a gun and shoots you. And the scenario could intensify to the 10th degree. We don't have time to go into all these today. But you know it. You live it. Your neighbor down the street, who you've known all these years, quiet people. Next thing you know, they end up on the 6 o'clock news. Husband kills wife and child and then himself, etc., etc., etc. Times to which we've come. But again, be mindful of the minutes as we approach our date with destiny. For the next few minutes, I'll be reading and commenting on a section in the book, Christ Object Lessons. The chapter is talent, section is time. Our time belongs to God. Every moment is his, and we are under the most solemn obligation to improve it to his glory. Of no talent he has given will he require a more strict account than of our time. That is why we're studying this today. That is why we spent this time this week to look at our date with destiny, because we understand these principles, that of no talent he has given will he require a more strict account than of our time. The value of time is beyond computation. Christ regarded every moment as precious, and it is thus that we should regard it. Life is too short to be trifled away, redeeming the times. We have but a few days of probation in which to prepare for eternity. We know the time. It's high time to awake. We have no time to waste, no time to devote to selfish pleasure, no time for the indulgence of sin. It is now that we are to form characters for the future immortal life. It is now that we are to prepare for the certain judgment. Again, our date with destiny. The human family have scarcely begun to live when they begin to die, and the world's incessant labor ends in nothing less unless a true knowledge in regard to eternal life is gained. The man who appreciates time as his working day will fit himself for a mansion and for a life that is immortal. It is well that he was born. Dear friends, do you see what we just read? The human family have scarcely begun to live when they begin to die. In fact, as soon as a baby is born, a baby begins to die. The cells begin to degenerate at birth. Sure, we get new ones, but cells are constantly dying every day, and the body itself is breaking down. Yes, beloved, even from day one. And that's why we need to be mindful of the minutes. We don't have long. And sad to say, in this world of ours, that very baby that we just spoke of just now, the minute he or she is born is the minute he or she could die. Such is life on planet Earth in the 21st century. Continue. We are admonished to redeem the time, but time squandered can never be recovered. We cannot call back even one moment. The only way in which we can redeem our time is by making the most of that which remains, by being co-workers with God in his great plan of redemption. Praise the Lord. Again, it's coming over and over again back to our minds. Time spent, time squandered, cannot be regained. It is up to us to be mindful of the minutes that we have left. In him who does this, a transformation of character takes place. He becomes a son of God, a member of the royal family, a child of the heavenly King. He is fitted to be the companion of the angels. Dear friends, that is exactly why we're doing what we're doing. Mindful of the minutes, redeeming the times, making sure that we're fitted as we prepare for our date with destiny. You see, friends, those who have chosen not to do this necessary preparation will meet face to face with God in front of the white throne judgment, while those who have sacrificed the desires and the lusts and the pleasures of this world to live a life wholly consecrated to God will have an appointment, a wedding feast, the marriage of the Lamb and his bride. You and I can be there if we just now redeem the time that we have left. Every moment is freighted with eternal consequences. We ought to stand as minutemen, ready for service at a moment's notice, mindful of the minutes. The opportunity that is now ours to speak to some needy soul, the word of life may never offer again. God may say to that one, this night thy soul shall be required of thee, and through our neglect, he may not be ready. Luke 12:20. In the great judgment day, how shall we render our account to God? How shall we stand in that great day? Dear friends, it is now high time that we awake. Now high time that we realize the time, the hour to which we've come, and not to be idle any longer in the marketplace. It's time to get to work. Yes, even in this late 11th hour, God has promised that the same pay that he gave to the first hour workers shall be yours. Life is too solemn to be absorbed in temporal and earthly matters. In a treadmill of care and anxiety for the things that are but an atom in comparison with the things of eternal interest. Yet God has called us to serve him in the temporal affairs of life. Diligent in this work is as much a part of true religion as is devotion. The Bible gives no endorsement to idleness. We just read that in Romans 13. It is the greatest curse that afflicts our world. Every man and woman who is truly converted will be a diligent worker. Not maybe, not might be, but will be. That's the transforming power of God. Upon the right improvement of our time depends our success in acquiring knowledge and mental culture. The cultivation of the intellect need not be prevented by poverty, humble origin, or unfavorable surroundings. Only let the moment be treasured. A few moments here and a few moments there that might be frittered away in aimless talk, the 1 hour so often wasted in bed, the time spent in traveling on trains or cars or waiting at the station, the moments of waiting for meals, waiting for those who are tardy in keeping an appointment. If a book were kept at hand and these fragments of time were improved in study, reading, or careful thought, what might not be accomplished? Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Let us be mindful of the minutes that we have, dear beloved, and every opportunity that we have while we're waiting. Let us take the time to improve our intellect, our spiritual connection with God. Let us take the time to be mindful that we have a date with destiny. Let us, by the grace of God, improve every opportunity to draw nearer to Jesus. A resolute purpose, persistent industry, and careful economy of time will enable men to acquire knowledge and mental discipline which will qualify them for almost any position of influence and usefulness. Through lack of determination to take themselves in hand and reform, persons can become stereotyped in the wrong course of action, or by cultivating their powers, they may acquire ability to do the very best of service. Then they will find themselves in demand anywhere and everywhere. They will be appreciated for all that they are worth. Redeeming the times. Dear friends, we're told in Ecclesiastes chapter 11 and verse 9, as we close, "Rejoice, O young man, in thy heart, and let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth, and walk in the ways of thine heart, and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou that for all these things God will bring thee into judgment. In other words, what we've been talking about just now, God is saying to us, my friends, listen. I will not stop you from adding your time away. I will not interfere in your free choice. In everything that you do, it will not be me to blame that you don't have fun, that you don't enjoy this life. The wise man says to the youth, the young, to all of us indeed, rejoice in it. Have fun. Do as you please. Live it up. But know that for all these things, God will bring you into judgment. That's what Jesus said, that every idle word that we speak will be judged by them. So again, dear friends, let us be mindful of the minutes. Let us be aware of the time to which we've come. Again, from Christ's Public Lessons on the chapter, The Talent, we close with these words. By many children and youth, time is wasted that might be spent in carrying home burdens and thus showing a loving interest in father and mother. The youth might take upon their strong young shoulders many responsibilities which someone must bear. The life of Christ from his earliest years was a life of earnest activity. He lived not to please himself. He was the son of the infinite God, yet he worked at the carpenter's trade with his father Joseph. His trade was significant. He had come into the world as a character builder, and as such, all his work was perfect. Into all his secular labor, he brought the same perfection as into the characters he was transforming by his divine power. He is our pattern. Parents should teach your children the value and right use of time. Teach them that to do something which will honor God and bless humanity is worth striving for. Even in their early years, they can be missionaries for God. So my dear young people, as we dwelt heavily on Tuesday's study on the importance of remembering now your Creator in the days of your youth, we close today's session by doing the same thing. Remember now your Creator in the days of your youth. And it is to prove my heart that if a young person is not by your side, dear parents, when you listen to this, that you grab your young person or you tell it, a young person, about this message. Because they need constantly to be reminded that life is not just about those three friends of yours, me, myself, and I. They need to be keenly aware that every moment of time that is wasted can never be returned. And especially as Christian children, they need to be forming characters such as Daniel and Esther had. Oh, dear friends, let us be aware that we need to redeem the time because the days are evil. Because we have a date with destiny, and destiny always has a way of keeping her appointments. Before we close out today, dear friends, I would just like to make an appeal to those who may be listening who have been squandering the time. Like that prodigal son in the parable, you've been extravagantly wasteful with time. No longer, by the grace of God, come to yourself, come to your senses, and do as we've talked about today in this study. Romans 13:11 again, and that knowing the time, that now it is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believed. It's time. It is high time. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you now so thankful that we have opportunity left to us to redeem the times, because we know, dear God, that the days are evil. Thank you for teaching us your way, O God. Thank you for leading us in a plain path. Thank you for doing for us that which we know that we cannot do for ourselves. And O Heavenly Father, I pray that we'll take this message serious, that we'll do that which is needed so that in the time that remains, all our thoughts, all our attention, all our desires, all our interests will be wrapped up with yours as we approach our date with destiny. Bless your words to our hearts. Bless every listener, dear God, and I pray that we'll take these words solemnly to heart and that they'll do the transforming work that was intended. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, friends, for joining us today on the Antidote to Deception Internet Radio Program. Remember that you can listen to the rebroadcast of these programs on our website at theantidotetodeception.com, theantidotetodeception.com/radio. Be blessed.
I wondered how to come to you. I did not dare believe it true that you regard the orphaned ones, beloved daughters, worthy sons. The broken and the barren too, I heard could find some rest in what kind of love in injury's place would leave in the stead the stain of grace? So I come in sorrow, and I come in shame. I come to the cross with my pain, just as I am.
Teaching the truth in love. man came to my Jesus, telling all that he had done to fulfill the good commandments. He knew every single one. Jesus said, there's something that indeed he did lack. The Savior told the truth. He didn't hold the message back. He was teaching the truth in love. Telling it like it is. While holding pure motives and showing that he cared, he was teaching the truth in love. An alibi, the truth so very obvious, made no attempt to lie. With all the foes against her, how she felt so all alone, till Jesus asked the people who would throw the first stone. He was teaching the truth in love, telling it like it is. While holding pure motives and showing that he cared, he was teaching the truth in love. Should we water down the message? Should we